really it's the Queen's family, because the Princess Royal is accompanying the Queen's body. And then, of course, some of the senior figures in the royal household, also with the coffin coming back. And we expect maybe the Prime Minister, the Defence Secretary, to be on the ground waiting as well. So, solemn, respectful, very important.
Hugely important for you, because this evening we are going to see Her Majesty the Queen return to her home and the seat of monarchy. And I think you touched on there the Princess Royal accompanying her mother, the Queen, on her final journey back home. We have had a very, very touching statement from Princess Royal tonight, which I think we'll be able to share with you a bit later. And there is something very special about her bringing her mother home. It's a very solemn evening. I think for a lot of people, we've seen all these incredible scenes in Scotland. Her journey from Balmoral to Edinburgh to Holyrood House and then, of course, on to St Giles's. There is going to be something that makes it even more real tonight, I think, for viewers, as they see the Queen return to England, to the seat of monarchy, where she's going to be met privately by members of the royal family. Quite a lot of the royal family actually this evening will be there to meet her coffin privately when it lies in rest tonight.
It's the moment when you see the coffin that it all comes home to you. If anybody watching, you know, remembers their own parents' death or not, it's you arrive at the church and you're almost sort of trying to keep the good humour going, and then you see the coffin and the reality of it dawns. And for the royal family, for the Princess Royal particularly, who yesterday travelled with her mother's body all the way from Balmoral, this must be so affecting, and it's affecting everybody. Interesting, I've been here every day at Buckingham House this week, and how the sense of emotion seems to be growing as the week has worn on, people feeling it more personally as time goes by.
Absorbing the news, considering what the impact of the news is, often in a personal way, because people tend to look back at their own lives, milestones in their own lives. I mean, in my case, I always think of my grandmother when I see the Queen. You know, it's an interesting, just one of those strong triggers, if you like, in terms of my own thoughts, and I'm sure it's the same for lots of us and for lots of these people gathered outside today. We'll have the Queen's Colour Squadron, by the way, such an impressive unit, who will be providing Guard of Honour, and indeed the bearer party, Queen's Colour Squadron, the Royal Air Force Regiment, standing by, and the welcoming party there, which will include senior figures from the military, and as I say, the Prime Minister and the Defence Secretary, Ben Wallace. And this really, for both of you, Giles and Royer, this is a journey which some might consider to be just part of a process of getting ready for the state funeral. And yet the way it's been done, the way that this has been managed, the way that there are crowds already gathered again at Buckingham Palace, just goes to show that no stage of this process is unimportant.
I think that's right, and talking about the crowds here, when I was making my way to the studio tonight, there were, this afternoon in fact, so many people gathering along the route that was published earlier today, and I think there is something incredibly poignant about the Queen whose Platinum Jubilee we were here celebrating just 3 months ago. There's something about the image in people's minds of the Queen at Buckingham Palace, you know, for so many of us, it's her coming out of the balcony, we saw her.
That balcony there.
Make that final.
Only 10, 11 weeks ago.
She made that amazing final appearance, they weren't sure she was going to do it. I think there is something moving about seeing her come back to London, to her home.
And in the midst of the sadness, let's remember, it is a 96-year-old. What a life of achievement. It is just extraordinary. So there is, while there is this personal grief, there's also a sense of celebrating a unique reign.
It's that phrase which just a member of the public who bumped into me today said, what a life. Mm-hmm. You know, it's something to celebrate. Of course, it's a great loss to the family. It's a great loss to millions of people who really regarded the Queen as a rock of solidity and constancy in their lives. I don't deny that for a second. But there is an element here as well of a need to acknowledge not just a long life, but a successful life and a life of achievement.
And actually to salute a good person. You know, there's so much bad in the world. To be able to actually say, look, we have had as our head of state somebody who's undeniably a good person. And for us to be here, this is what the Duke of Edinburgh used to call the headquarters of the family firm.
Yes.
And that she is coming home here tonight for a final night of Buckingham.
I think the other important point to make here is that we are seeing all these dignitaries and, you know, the Prime Minister and other people in the military welcome her back. this is the last night the royal family have with the Queen to themselves. Tomorrow they hand her over to the nation that I'm in state. I think that'll be a very poignant moment too for the family.
Squadron leader Brydon is looking after the guard of honour. But of course, we have Air Chief Marshal Sir Mike Wigton, who's presiding over this exercise, this very solemn exercise by the Royal Air Force. He's part of the welcoming party, and we just saw a glimpse of him a short while ago. He will be, I'm sure, greeting the Princess Royal when she emerges from the Globemaster, when it finally finishes taxiing. And then we'll see, of course, the bearer party to bring the Queen's coffin from the airport, the bearer party from 63 Squadron, the RAF Regiment, will be charged with that duty, and what a privilege for them. It's a huge honour for them too.
It's interesting. Every military person you meet has got a story to tell about knowing the Queen. I don't think I've met anybody in the last few days who didn't seem to know the Queen. Everybody has either seen her, met her, got a story to tell. It's wonderful. I suppose in 96 years you would have touched a lot of lives. It's interesting too that we're coming to Buckingham Palace because, of course, our favourite homes were Windsor and Balmoral. This was the official headquarters. And I know that when she became Queen back in 1952, she and the Duke of Edinburgh were thinking that maybe they could stay at Clarence House and that this could be the headquarters of the office. But Sir Winston Churchill, Prime Minister of the time, said, oh, this is the place where you've got to be seen, to be in command.
He had other ideas, and of course he just recognised that the symbolism of Buckingham Palace was indivisible with the authority and the visibility of the royal family. So I think strict orders were given to move.
Yes, and it's been a royal palace since the, royal palace since it was Buckingham House, and it was rebuilt by the architect and builder Thomas Cubitt, who by interesting coincidence was the great-great-great-grandfather of the new Queen Consort.
So this is the scene at RAF Northolt, which by the way is the oldest Royal Air Force base in the United Kingdom, with very close ties to the Royal Family. The Queen has been using this airbase many, many times over the years on her travels. And this is the point of arrival back in London, just on the outskirts of West London, on this rather solemn evening, a rather grey evening, a rather damp evening. And the guard of honour there, provided by the Queen's Colour Squadron, who are waiting, as they have been for about 10, 15 minutes. And there we have just a glimpse there of the Defence Secretary Ben Wallace, and next to him on his right, the Prime Minister Liz Truss, all waiting silently and solemnly for the aircraft to come to a full stop and for the engines to be switched off, and then of course for the bearer party to carefully and very slowly and solemnly and silently bring up the coffin bearing the Queen's body. This really is a very big moment for so many people. It's the moment when, as Giles was saying a short while ago, it's a moment when you catch a glimpse of the coffin itself, having seen it in Edinburgh, but now seeing it not in Scotland, but in England, and within a short time we'll be back in Buckingham Palace, the scene of so many happy times and happy appearances for Her Majesty over the decades.
You mentioned the weather. It's very British weather. This is a very British way of doing things. And the transition that we've seen this week shows that this extraordinary system of constitutional monarchy that we have, eccentric, arcane, unusual, but somehow it seems to have worked.
waiting here at the RAF Norfolk in silence and a show of respect for the Queen's return. It's a time for us all to reflect on what this return means and to reflect too on the richness of the Queen's life and what she's contributed over the longest reign in British history. But it's a moment that will touch so many people. It's a sense of the Queen returning home. Yes, of course, she was at home in Balmoral, but home in the sense of work has been Buckingham Palace. And that is the prime symbol of the Queen's presence in London. Station commander, just approaching the aircraft. Captain Turia McFadden, she's with the Princess Royal, who's just emerged, that's right, from the aircraft. And Vice Admiral Timothy Lawrence, the Princess Royal, who spent quite a few days at Balmoral. And as Roya was saying just a short while ago, has been really dedicated to her mother's care. And I believe we can maybe share some of the words that she has published this evening.
That's right. Princess Royal has just issued an incredibly moving statement in which she says, "I was fortunate to share the last 24 hours of my dearest mother's life. It has been an honour and a privilege to accompany her on her final journeys. Witnessing the love and respect shown by so many on these journeys has been both humbling and uplifting." She talks about how we've been reminded of how much her presence and contribution to our national identity and how we may have taken that for granted. She talks about how she's delighted to so many people have offered understanding to her dear brother Charles as he accepts the added responsibilities of the monarch. And she says, "And to my mother, the Queen, thank you." It's a very moving statement, and I think there's something about, you know, Princess Royal bringing her mother back, how she spent that last 24 hours with her and was accompanying her on that final journey. It's a very, very moving statement from the Princess Royal.
The Princess Royal, the hardest working member of the Royal Family, was on Wednesday fulfilling engagements in the Scottish Island. She was in the Isle of Skye, so she was nearby and was able to be with her mother from Wednesday night onwards, and has been with her ever since. Two people said to me this afternoon coming through Green Park, one about the king, saying he's been every inch a king. And then he said about the Princess Royal, what a wonderful daughter.
Well, the wait in silence and wait in deep respect for the Queen's coffin to be brought from the Royal Air Force aircraft by the bearer party. There we see the Air Chief Marshal, Sir Mike Wigton, just in the centre of the frame, and with the Princess Royal and her husband, Timothy Lawrence. The banner, the insignia, draped in black. Body of Her Late Majesty, Queen Elizabeth II, emerges from the Royal Air Force plane brought by the bearer party, the Queen's Colour Squadron, 63 Squadron of the Royal Air Force Regiment. Party done its work crisply and perfectly, and the state hearse will soon be setting off for central London. Beautiful tribute that we heard from the Princess Royal to her late mother. The privilege of having spent the last 24 hours with her at Balmoral. The journey is underway. There, including, of course, representatives of the church, politics, and the military. standard of the King's Colour Squadron, the very powerful signal of respect because it's touching the ground, something you rarely see. Journey begins towards Buckingham Palace. It should take possibly around 40-45 minutes, but clearly it's a very slow and solemn journey. The police outriders and the Metropolitan Police clearing the way. The rain is falling. The headlamps are on already. And they leave the Royal Air Force Base at Norfolk on that western approach to central London. And the Princess Royal will be joining her brother, the King, back at Buckingham Palace. My colleague, Sonali Shah, has been witnessing the events there.
Hugh, as the roar of the engines shut down